today on Path of Grace.
Peter himself did not in the least bit imply that Paul needed to teach Gentiles to observe the law of Moses. At this meeting that they had, when Pete was checking out Paul to confirm that he was really commissioned by Christ, it would have been the perfect time for Pete to set Paul straight if he needed to be set straight, and to tell Paul to go out and tell the Gentiles to get circumcised and start observing the feasts and festivals in order to make God happy with them. But that did not happen. Instead, Peter only gives Paul one instruction that's found in verse 10. Here it is: only of the poor that we should be mindful, which also I was diligent this very thing to do. Hey there, my friend. Once again today, we will be continuing our journey together through Paul's letter to the Galatians, taking it up once more in chapter 2. As Paul continues to share with his readers, that's you and me, about his background, calling, and mission. Now, if you missed the previous studies in Galatians, go ahead and stop this audio now and give a listen to the previous 5 audios. That's important to do because we're taking things up today kind of in mid-thought in verse 7 as Paul talks about a difference or a contrast between what he had been given to do and what Peter had been given to do by Christ. In Galatians chapter 2, verses 7 and 8, he says this: "But on the contrary, having seen that I have been entrusted with the good news of the uncircumcision, as Peter with that of the circumcision, for he who did work with Peter to the apostleship of the circumcision did work also in me in regard to the nations." Now, Paul had already, earlier on in this letter, spoken of getting his evangel, his gospel, his good news through a direct revelation from Christ and not from any other human being. Paul had been an enemy of everything having to do with Christ until the risen Lord directly intervened out of the blue on the road to Damascus. And then it was several years, Paul tells us, before he ever consulted with the apostles Christ had appointed earlier. And here in verse 7, in Young's literal translation, Paul says, "I have been entrusted with the good news of the uncircumcision," and Peter had been given the good news of the circumcision. He says that he, meaning the Lord, worked with Peter to the apostleship of the circumcision and also worked in Paul in regard to the nations or the Gentiles. Is this a big deal? Yeah, I think it is. In other words, Paul is saying that he had been given good news, the gospel, to take to the non-Jews, and Peter had been given good news for the Jews, for the circumcision. Now, here's some questions to consider. Did Christ give Peter and Paul the exact same message, or was it different? Did it have the same exact focus in every single aspect, or were there some minor differences in some places? If it was exactly the same, why would Christ have had to call Paul to begin with? Now, there is a very popular, easy-to-read paraphrase of the Bible called The Message. It's not a translation. It's one man's paraphrase, and it sold millions of copies because it is so easy to read. In fact, I enjoy reading it sometimes, but it is not a translation. It is more of a commentary written by one man as a paraphrase of Scripture, and so it carries with it a lot of his ideas and preconceived notions, just as it would if you were to write a paraphrase of the Scripture or if I were to do the same. Anyway, The Message words verse 7 like this: "It was soon evident that God had entrusted me with the same message to the non-Jews as Peter had been preaching to the Jews." Well, again, if it was the exact same message, why would God have called Paul in the first place when he already had Peter? And why would Paul have gone out of his way in so many verses leading up to this to make the point that his message had been uniquely given to him by the Lord and not given to him by someone like Peter? If in its complete entirety his message was exactly the same as Paul and the same message was going out to these two distinct groups, Jews and non-Jews, why would Peter in his second letter say that some of what Paul writes and teaches is hard to understand? If it was the exact same message with the exact same focus on every single point, Why would any portion of it have been hard for Peter to understand? Why would it have been hard for him to grasp if it was the exact same message? The New King James words verses 7 and 8 this way. But on the contrary, when they saw that the gospel for the uncircumcised had been committed to me as the gospel for the circumcised was to Peter, for he who worked effectively in Peter for the apostleship to the circumcised also worked effectively in me toward the Gentiles. So here in the New King James, Paul refers to the gospel for the uncircumcised, the gospel, the good news, the evangel for the non-Jews being committed to him, and the gospel for the circumcised, for the Jews being committed to Peter. Good news for the Gentiles coming through Paul, good news for Jews being given through Peter. Peter was given apostleship to the Jews, Paul given apostleship to the Gentiles. Let this sink in for a second because I think it is very important. The gospel, the good news for the uncircumcised, good news for the Gentiles. That's what Paul was given. Peter was given good news for Jews. And as these messages were contrasted, as Peter heard what Paul had to say, he accepted that it was from the Lord, but at the same time, he would also say, it's hard to understand what Paul is talking about when it comes to certain aspects of his message. Now, what might those things be that would be hard for Peter to understand? He doesn't tell us exactly, but one that I think Peter might have been referring to, and this is my opinion, is that the focus of the kingdom of heaven, as Christ walked on the earth and spoke to the Jews about it, and we've all heard those verses about the kingdom of heaven, right? The focus was a kingdom which would come to the earth, a kingdom God had promised the Jews way, 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 way back in the book of Genesis. Christ taught his followers to pray, thy kingdom come. You remember that phrase, right? And what's called the Lord's Prayer, which we ought to call the disciples' prayer because he was teaching it to those Jewish disciples. Part of that prayer is to pray that the kingdom would come. Now, where would the kingdom come? They were on the earth and they were praying for the kingdom to come to the earth. They weren't looking to die and go to the kingdom of heaven. They were looking for the kingdom to come to the earth. And their hope and the hope of every Jew was to be a part of that kingdom. They looked forward to their dead loved ones one day to be resurrected, to be a part of that kingdom. The focus was the kingdom on the earth. Have you ever heard the phrase, the meek shall inherit what? The earth. We've all heard that phrase. And for the circumcised, for the Jews, the focus of the message was earth, what God would do on the earth through their nation. They looked forward to a new earth. Peter talked about that in his good news. In contrast, though, when you read Paul's letters, he didn't have so much of an earthly focus for the Gentiles. His focus was on the heavens, or as some translations word it, the heavenlies. And as Paul wrote to Gentiles, his focus seemed to be more on God's plan for us, Gentiles, having to do with something in the heavenlies, things that we look forward to that are beyond the scope of earth. Now, the Bible doesn't give us a whole lot of details on these things, but as you read Paul's letters, you get little glimpses. And I think that this aspect of the heavenlies for the Gentiles might be part of what Peter was referring to when he said, you know, some of what Paul talks about is hard to understand because as a Jew, everything in his life, his whole paradigm, his way of seeing things had been on the kingdom to come to the earth. Anyway, that's just one example of what I think might be a difference in the messages that were given to the two different groups through these two different men for a specific purpose in each case. And you could probably spend a year or two of your own time looking at and comparing the messages, the good news, the evangels of these two guys for these two different people groups, and do some comparison and contrast. You'd probably come up with things that I haven't mentioned today that might make them a bit different. But regardless of the minor differences, ultimately for Jews and Gentiles in these two guys' messages given to them by Christ, the focus we've got to see is that it's still on Christ, the only begotten Son of God, who is the Savior, who died as the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world, and who rose again from the dead. It's really Christ-focused. Next, we come to verse 9. And having known the grace that was given to me, James and Cephas and John, who were esteemed to be pillars, a right hand of fellowship. They did give to me and to Barnabas that we to the nations and they to the circumcision may go. In other words, Paul is saying that when he met with Peter, Pete clearly saw and understood that Christ had indeed called Paul and that he and Barnabas had been given a special work to do among the nations, among the non-Jews, while at the same time, James, Cephas, and John, by the way, Cephas is the Aramaic name for Peter. That would have been the word that Jesus used, speaking Aramaic. In this verse, it speaks of James, Cephas, and John. That's James, Peter, and John had been given the ministry to the Jews, to the circumcision. Now again, let this sink in. Peter, James, and John, who had walked with Christ for 3 years before his death and resurrection, saw themselves as meant to only go to the Jews, the circumcision. That was their world, was the Jewish people, the circumcision. Apparently, they saw their focus pretty much the same as what Christ had said his focus was when he walked on the earth. Something a lot of people miss is a statement Jesus made, and you can find it in the gospel accounts, where he said, "I have not come except for the lost sheep of the house of Israel." Now, we know he came as the Lamb of God to take away the sin of the whole world, but his focus in his earthly ministry was the lost sheep of the house of Israel. It was to the Jews. His words, his ministry, his teaching, almost all of his interaction was with the Jews only, and it had to do with the kingdom that would come to the earth. Now, let's move on. We come to something that is huge and ties in with the reason Paul had written to the Galatians. Remember, the Galatians had been led off course and duped into thinking that in order to make God happy, they as non-Jews needed to begin to observe the law of Moses, including getting circumcised. See, they had been taught that what Jesus had done wasn't quite enough. He may have died for their sins, but to really live a day-to-day life that pleases God, you need to follow all these rules and regulations, including having part of your penis snipped off. But Paul, in his letters, spoke against this, saying that you and I are not under the law, but under grace, that there is no list of rules or regulations, religious rituals, obligations, or ceremonies, or anything else we need to do in order to approach God or relate to God or make God happy. It's all wrapped up in Christ. And here in this letter, we find, as he talks about his meeting with Peter, this pillar among the Jews, and as Peter recognized Christ had commissioned Paul to go to the Gentiles, Peter himself did not in the least bit imply that Paul needed to teach Gentiles to observe the law of Moses. At this meeting that they had, when Pete was checking out Paul to confirm that he was really commissioned by Christ, it would have been the perfect time for Pete to set Paul straight if he needed to be set straight, and to tell Paul to go out and tell the Gentiles to get circumcised and start observing the feasts and festivals in order to make God happy with them. But that did not happen. Instead, Peter only gives Paul one instruction that's found in verse 10. Here it is: "Only of the poor that we should be mindful, which also I was diligent this very thing to do." My friend, this is huge. Even Peter recognized that when it comes to us non-Jews, to us Gentiles, and what Paul was supposed to teach us, as far as religion goes, it's not about rituals. It's not about special days of observance. It's not about snipping off the end of a baby boy's penis. It's not about dietary laws and regulations. Our standing with God and our relating to God isn't based upon any of those things. Instead, it's based upon absolutely and only what Christ has done for us. That's good news. And so Peter didn't give Paul any religious rituals for us to do to get in good with God. Instead, he simply wanted Paul to teach us to love one another and to take care of one another, to make sure that the needs of the less fortunate around us are met. Let me read verse 10 again. Paul says, "Only of the poor, that we should be mindful, which also I was diligent this very thing to do." My friend, how much more sense does it make to devote our time to loving one another and taking care of one another than to devote our time to rituals and religion? How much more good is done when our focus is on meeting practical needs of people around us rather than focusing on religious dietary laws and snipping off pieces of our anatomy? If you've been looking for practical, real-life expression of following Christ as a Gentile, then here's what you do. Take care of the people around you. Take care of the less fortunate. And if you're looking for practical instruction from an apostle, As a Gentile, you need to look at the writings of the Apostle Paul. If you want to get an idea of what the future holds for you and me at the end of the ages, then I think you're going to find what you're looking for in the writings of Paul. After all, he was the one who was given good news from Christ to take to the uncircumcised, to the non-Jews, to the Gentiles. My name is James Flanders. Thank you for spending time with me today. I'm so blessed to have you as part of my life, and I so look forward to our time together. Thank you so much for your prayers. Father knows that I need them. And thank you for those occasional positive, encouraging words. Man, don't we all need that in a world of such negativity and hatred to hear something positive from some friends? It means so much, and I appreciate that. My hope is that these teachings are an encouragement to you as you grow in the grace of our loving Father and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Be blessed, my friend. Be blessed.